Today, we'll be covering the basics of animating in Blender by creating this abstract animation. Make sure to catch up on the last tutorials in the course if you want to follow along. The link is in the description if you're interested, or in the top right hand corner. To start off, I'm going to animate my swirls. So first, I'm going to pull up this timeline here by left clicking the top and just pulling up, and I'm going to move this thing called the playhead to frame 1. You can see if I left click in here, I can move it to a different frame. I can also control it with this button here. I can just type in the number I want to move it to, for example 1, and now the blue playhead is at frame 1. This is important because when we add a keyframe, we want to make sure we add it to the right frame, and that will be determined by the playhead. I'll left click this swirl and I'm going to press I, and this will bring up an insert keyframe menu. A keyframe is pretty much saving the information of animation in a certain point on the timeline. I'm going to choose rotation since I'm only going to be rotating this object, but if I wanted to move it, I would choose location or location and rotation if I wanted to move it and rotate it. Now I've done that, you can see a yellow diamond shape has appeared at frame 1 on our timeline. This is to show that the rotation of this object has been saved at frame 1. Then I wanted to move 180 degrees by frame 250. So I'm going to left click 250 and then I'm going to press R, Z, and then type in 180 to move it 180 degrees. R stands for rotation and Z means rotating it across the up and down axis, or the Z axis, which is that blue line you see here. Once I've rotated it, you need to make sure you don't change frame on the timeline, otherwise it will reset it. Even though I've just done that, you can see nothing's changed, and that's because this object is symmetrical. So I'm going to go back to 250 and press RZ and then 180 again to 180 degrees. Then I'll press I and then rotation in order to save the rotation at this point. Now if I press the spacebar to play, you can see our object is now rotating. Now I'm going to repeat the process for the second swirl. So I'll left click it, press I and then choose rotation. Then I'll come to frame 250 and press R, and this time I'm going to choose X because I want to rotate it around this red line, which is the X axis. I'm going to choose RX and I'm going to choose 180. Then I'll press I and then I'll choose rotation. And now you can see we've encountered a bit of an issue. Our second swirl isn't rotating as we'd expect. And this is to do with issues with local and global axis. To fix this, I'm going to want to first come to my timeline and press A to select all. Just like with objects, you can select keyframes by left clicking, and you can also even move them by pressing G. So the first thing I'll do is I'm going to come to frame 1, and then I'm going to come to my keyframes and press A and then X to delete. So it's A for all and then X to delete. It's also really important that you do this at frame 1, because if I was to delete the keyframes at a different frame, it will be slightly rotated still. So now I've done that, I'm going to do something called applying the rotation. So to do that, I'll press Ctrl A and then choose rotation. What that's done is it's made this 3D swirls rotation the default rotation for the object, meaning you won't have any issues with the local axis. You can also fix this rotation issue using empties and object constraints. I'm then going to add my keyframes again. So I'll press I and then I'm going to choose rotation. Then I'm going to come to frame 250, press R, X, and then 180 to rotate it 180 degrees. Then press I and then rotation again. And now when I press play, you can see the rotation is working as expected. If you wanted the swirl to rotate in the other direction, you could go ahead and left click this keyframe, press X to delete it. You'll see now that the rotation is no longer rotated 180 degrees because I deleted that keyframe, and it will now use the rotation of the last marked keyframe, which was 0. What I can do is I can press R, X, and then choose minus 180, which will move it 180 degrees in the other direction, and then choose I and then rotation. And now you can see it's rotating in the other direction. So you can pick which one you prefer. Next up, we're going to want to rotate both of these swirls at the same time. But if we do this manually, we'll probably encounter that strange rotation issue again. So in order to prevent that, we're going to use the empty and object constraint I touched on earlier. So I'll zoom out a little bit and then I'm going to press Shift A, and then under empty, I'm going to choose plane axes. If I press G and X to pull this along this red line here, and I might press S to scale it down. This will be a controller for our swirl designs. So I'll press G and Z and maybe move it down a little bit. So I'll press G and Z and maybe I'll move it out to the left by pressing G and then Y. Now if I rotate this empty by pressing R and Y, because I want to rotate it along this axis, you can see the swirls aren't moving, and that's because we need to actually assign our swirls to our empty. We can do this by parenting it, but I like to use the constraints in order to introduce them to you. So first I'm going to left click my 3D swirl here, and I'm going to come to this menu here, which looks like two wheels on a caterpillar track, and under add object constraint, I'm going to choose child of. This will pretty much make it so this swirl will be attached to the target. And I'm going to make the target this empty. Now if I left click my empty again and press R, you can see the swirl now moves with it. This will make it easier to animate both of these at the same time. And then I'm going to do the same process for the other one. So I'm going to left click the other swirl, then come to this menu here in the constraints menu, add object constraint, and you can just choose child of. Select your target as the empty again, and you're all good to go. I'm going to left click my empty and come to frame one. I'm first going to press I again and choose rotation, since we're only keyframing rotation. Then you can come to frame 250, press R, Y, and then 90 to move it 90 degrees. But you can see we have an issue, and that's that our objects aren't moving perfectly in the middle. For now, I'll just press I and then rotation to save that rotation, and you can see how this rotation might not be how I've desired it. One simple fix is to make this empty more centered. So I'll come to the side here, and I'm going to try and better align it to the center. So first, I'll left click my swirls, and I'm just going to press this I button to disable the child of constraint, and I'm doing this for the other one too. Then I'm going to left click my empty again, and I'm going to press G and X, and I'll just move it to the center. Then I'll need to reset these child of constraints, so I'm just going to press X to remove them, and then I'm going to add them again by pressing child of, and I'm going to choose the empty again, and do the same for the other constraint. Now when I play the animation, you can see it rotates perfectly in the center, just as we'd hoped. Now we're going to add an empty for the camera too, because I want to rotate the camera a little bit. I'll press Shift A, and I'm going to create a brand new empty. I'm just going to choose plane axes again. I'll zoom out so I can see it, press G and X to move it out, and to avoid the issue we had last time, and also to make the animation look a little nicer, I'm going to make sure it is in the center, which currently it is, but I just want to make sure it's on the center of the y-axis too, so I've just moved it back a little bit. I've done that using G and X. Then I'll press S to scale it down, and I'll press G and Z to maybe pull it to around here. If you find it a little bit too hard to see, you can press G and Z to just pull it underneath. Now I'm going to left click my camera, and in the constraints tab, I'm going to choose a child of constraint for the camera too, and I'll make the target this empty here. In order for organization, I'm actually going to go ahead and name some things here. So our camera is named appropriately, but we're also going to want to name this empty here. So I'll rename it by double clicking it and then calling it swirl controller. For the other empty, I'm going to double click and rename it to camera controller. As for this big plane here, I'm going to double click this and I'm going to rename it to studio background. I'll also name my tessellation to swirl 1 and swirl 2. If you want to be extra organized, we can also name our old base and component objects to just torus to base and plane to component. There. Now our scene is a little bit more organized. I'll left click my empty, and if I press R and Z, you can see I can now rotate my camera easily on the Z axis. So I'm going to come to frame 1, and I'm going to go into camera view by pressing the film camera so I can see what I'm doing here. I'll maybe press R and Z, and I'll rotate it a little bit to the left here. You're going to want to make sure the studio isn't completely out of the scene, but we can also scale it up later. I'll maybe press R, Z, and then minus 10, so I can rotate it 10 degrees to the left. I'll then press I, and then I'm going to choose rotation. Then I'm going to come to frame 250 here, and I'm going to press R, Z, and then 20, just to rotate it 20 degrees in the other direction. I'll then press enter, then I, and then choose rotation. Now, about the studio, it's a little bit too small in order to fit our animation, so I can just press S to scale it. Or if you don't want to change where the bend bit is, you can just press S and Y, so only scale on the Y axis, making it bigger in that direction only. Now you can see we've got no issues when we play the animation. Also, if you want to make sure you're playing your animation at the right frame rate, I'll come to my output properties, and I'm going to change my frame rate to 30 frames per second, because I believe that looks a little bit smoother. You can also see here, I've got my resolution X and Y, and this will allow me to change the dimensions of the camera. For example, if I wanted to make it look like it was shot on a phone, I could change it to 1080 by 1920. Instead. But I'm going to reset that to the default. Also, if you want to move your camera closer, you can just left click the camera and you can press G and then Z twice. What this will do is move it on its local Z axis, and that's a great way to move it forward and backward, and that won't affect the rotation at all since we didn't keyframe the camera itself with any location. Do keep in mind that sometimes Blender struggles to play the animation at the correct frame rate, so the animation may appear slower than it will in the final render, so do keep that in mind. One important thing to remember is because this is a 30 frames per second animation, for every 30 frames here in the timeline, 1 second will pass. One thing you may notice though is in all of our objects, the rotation starts slowly and then gets slower near the end, but in the middle it's at its fastest. But if you want to make sure it's moving at the same speed the whole time, we'll need to change the interpolation mode. I'm going to keep the empties at default, which is Bezier, but for these swirls, I'm going to want to change them to linear, which will make it so it's moving at a constant speed the entire time. To do that, I'm just going to left click one of my swirls, and then in this menu, I'll press A to select all my keyframes, right click, and here you've got interpolation mode. Bezier is the default, so I'm going to change it to linear. Now if I play my animation, you can see this swirl here is moving at a constant rate, whereas this one is slightly slow and then speeding up, and then slowing down at the end again. So I'll need to do the same thing for the second one too. Since I've got a left click, I'm going to pause my animation, come to my timeline, Press A to select everything, right click, and under interpolation mode, I'll change it to linear. And now everything should be working nicely. You can, of course, left click the empty and make these linear too, but I like to keep them on Bezier for now. If you want to get a better visual idea of what's happening here, I'm going to change from timeline to graph editor. No need to follow along with this because there's nothing else you need to do for this tutorial. If I zoom out here, you can see that this linear keyframe has a straight diagonal line, showing that it's moving at a constant pace. Whereas our empty, which is still using a Bezier interpolation, down here you can see how it's more curved at the bottom, which is why it can slow down near the end and also start slow at the beginning. You can even edit this as well to get different results with the animation, but this is a little bit advanced for this tutorial. We're going to change back to timeline. Great job for following along and creating this animation. Now we're going to go over a quick quiz to revise what we've learned today. Number one, what key did we press to add a keyframe? Number two, what object constraint did we use to control our 3D swirls and camera with empties? Number three, what is the difference between linear and Bezier interpolation? Feel free to pause the video and take your time to answer the questions. Then when you're ready, you can press play and listen to the answers. Number one, how did we add a keyframe? To add a keyframe, we first selected the object, then we pressed I to open the keyframe menu, then we chose the type of transform we wanted to make. For example, if I wanted to animate how big or small the object was, I would choose scale, but we'd done rotation, so that's why we would left click rotation, and that would mark our keyframe at the point in the timeline. For us, we wanted to do this at frame 1, so we went to frame 1, pressed I, and then chose rotation. We then had to go to the end frame, and then add a second keyframe with a different rotation, in order for Blender to know what change to make on the timeline as it's playing. Number 2. What object constraint did we use to control our 3D swirls and camera with empties? For this, we used the child of constraint, which is found in the object constraints menu when you have the object selected. We added this to the swirl and then we made the target the empty, which we will use as the parent, if you like, to control this object. We've done the same for the camera, and then once we'd had our constraints set up, we could move and animate the empties in order to control our camera and our swirls. Number three, what's the difference between linear and Bezier interpolation? Linear interpolation will make it so it's moving at a constant speed, whereas Bezier, the default type of interpolation, will make it so it starts off slow, speeds up, and then slows down near the end of the next keyframe. Great job on completing the quiz. Feel free to let me know your answers in the comment below if you're unsure if you got them right or not. You can also let me know of any questions you may have. Don't forget as well, there's also a free PDF guide accompanied with this tutorial as well as with every other tutorial in this course. In the next lesson, we're going to be going over the lighting for our scene. Also, if you enjoy my teaching style, I also provide one-on-one coaching completed with personalized lessons and post-lesson quiz questions and support. Link in the description if you're interested. Thank you for making it to the end of the video. You can also support the channel by making a one-time donation through Super, but even just liking, subscribing, and sharing if you enjoyed is more than enough to support the channel. Thank you again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.